welcome to Firebird Sports Magazine. I'm Patricia Thomas, Director of Intercollegiate Athletics for the University of the District of Columbia. Originally called stickball, lacrosse was a tribal game played by Eastern Woodlands Native Americans and by some Plains tribes in the United States and Canada. Legends suggest tribal warriors played the game for training, recreation, and religious reasons. In the early 1600s, French Jesuits working in the St. Lawrence Valley were the first Europeans to see the game, which has developed over the years into the interscholastic, professional, and international sport enjoyed today. According to the national governing body, U.S. Lacrosse, surveys indicate lacrosse is the fastest growing team sport in America. The legendary Pro Football Hall of Famer, Jim Brown, was the first team All-American in lacrosse at Syracuse University. In 1984, he told the New York Times, "Lacrosse is probably the best sport I ever played." In his senior year, the midfielder was second in the nation in goals scored. Jim Brown was inducted into the Lacrosse Hall of Fame in 1983. Formed in 1970 by Howard Chip Silverman, Morgan State University became the first historically black university to field a men's lacrosse team. Ranked in the top 25 nationally, one of the greatest intercollegiate upsets occurred in 1975 when Morgan defeated Washington and Lee University, handing the Division I powerhouse its first loss of the season and first home loss in three seasons. The Bears program was dropped in 1981. In 2014, the University of the District of Columbia was the only historically black university to sponsor lacrosse on the NCAA level. Hampton University became the second HBCU in the country when it fielded a team in 2016. The University of the District of Columbia hopes to take advantage of the explosion of the popularity of lacrosse and looks to build an exciting intercollegiate activity for both its student athletes and growing of the District of Columbia fans. On this edition of Firebird Sports Magazine, I talk with University of the District of Columbia head men's lacrosse coach, Rodger Colbert. Rodger Colbert took over as head coach of the University of the District of Columbia men's lacrosse program in 2016. An experienced educator, Colbert taught math at St. Paul's School in Concord, New Hampshire, where he also served as coordinator of multicultural programming. A graduate of the Petty School, an independent boarding high school in Hightstown, New Jersey, he returned to his alma mater where he coached lacrosse, basketball, and football, in addition to serving as assistant director of admissions and coordinator of multicultural recruitment. An All-American defenseman at Petty and Georgetown University, where he was selected team captain senior year, Rodger Colbert was drafted as the 12th overall pick in the Major League Lacrosse Draft and enjoyed a six-year professional career following graduation from Georgetown. In his second season as head coach of the Firebirds, Coach Colbert is making great strides as he continues to build the program. Coach, it's my understanding that your long-term career goal was to be a principal. And you actually attended Harvard and obtained your master's degree in education and actually spent a few years as an administrator of various secondary schools in Massachusetts, New Hampshire, and New Jersey. So now you're coaching lacrosse at the University of the District of Columbia. How did you switch paths? Why?
Well, why, first and foremost, is because my wife said it's okay. So let's just be clear. We were up in New Hampshire, New England, and she was a professor at Dartmouth, and I was working in the school system, like you said, in attending schools. And we decided what the next steps were. She asked me what I wanted. I said, I want to be a lacrosse coach, nothing more, nothing less. And so we figured out how to begin that journey. And so it began with her getting a job at Georgetown, which she currently, she works at now, and me coming down and working at a high school, Osborne Park, and volunteering with Scott Urich, who was the head coach here at UDC. And so after a year or so of working and volunteering with UDC, Scott asked me to come on as the assistant, and it was a natural transition for me. My goal has always been to educate young people, and use lacrosse as a vehicle to do it. And so it sort of dovetailed perfectly into what I want to do. And more specifically, students of color in the sport of lacrosse. So merging those two, the amalgamation of both of those, it was right at UDC, so it made it easy.
That's a great story. It's a great story. You were an outstanding defenseman at Georgetown University under the legendary Dave York. Talk about the lessons that you learned as a Hoya, and maybe tell me about one of your most memorable experiences on the Hilltop.
I think one of Coach York's sayings sums it up best. He used to always say, every day is a holiday and every meal is a banquet. And so taking that approach to the game and to life, you know, it makes you have a positive outlook on each day.
Yes.
So if you say that to your young people every day, you say that to yourself, you tend to be able to move forward through whatever it is you have to move through. And so that was probably the biggest life lesson that I learned with Coach U. And the greatest experience probably was making the Final Four and being the only Georgetown team that made the Final Four in 1999, 2000. And you know, that was right in the middle of my career. So I was happy to see the upperclassmen make it to a certain point. And it was great to see the young people lead Georgetown into the next decade or so of success on the lacrosse field.
Was that the year you beat Duke?
Yes. Okay. Yes. And the first time we beat Duke,
right.
too. That's a way to put it. Yep.
Yes.
Yep. Yep. So that was.
Brings back memories for me.
Absolutely. You were there.
Now, no stranger to competing professionally, you enjoyed a 6-year career playing for three different programs.
Yes.
I understand. But interestingly, you indicated that Bill Russell was your favorite athlete,
sure.
Which likely will bring us back to defense, but we
sure.
can talk about that later. But tell me about Bill Russell and what he means to you.
It was his journey, right? So if you look at my background, it's an inner city kid that has gone to a bunch of different prep schools as a result of having a benefactor. And what that essentially means for me is that some people in the city of Newark, New Jersey recognized that I had a gift, whether it be athletically or academically, and they took and said, I want you to go to this school, this prep school, or this private school. And those people make sure that the bill was paid for so that I can go to school without any worries, or my mother didn't have to worry about paying the bills. And so when I say Bill Russell, I say, you know, those environments were filled in people other than the people in Newark, New Jersey. So there weren't black people in these environments. There tend to be Caucasian people in these environments. And there were some, but ultimately I was around that all of the time. And Bill Russell was one, you know, they say the token, so to speak, person of color. While I was the one, I never felt like a token, but just his journey emulated mine in the sense that we were surrounded and being the only ones on the court. And so naturally I assumed his number of six, and I've always wanted to be a champion like Bill. And so when you're young, you want to win. There's nobody that did it better than Bill Russell. And so that's where I get my sort of liking to Bill. I wanted to win. I was one of not many in environments in which we had to play and live life. So.
So why lacrosse? I know you've had experience coaching basketball, football. Clearly you're athletic.
When I was young, it was just everyone wanted to play the other sports. And like, I've never wanted to do everything that everyone else did. I've never been that guy.
Yeah.
In fact, some of my friends that have gotten in trouble over the year always say, well, you make your own decisions. I've always respected you for that. And that's been my personality. So lacrosse seems to be, no one's shining in it. You hear names like Jim Brown played, and you say, well, hold on, if Jim Brown played, that means I can play. And so once I learned a little bit more about it and learned its origins with the Native Americans, I said, well, that sport is more for me than the other sports were because of its beginnings. And it became natural. Like, it was easy to get good at lacrosse. It's hard to get great, but it was easy to get good at it for me. And so naturally, lacrosse, it presented more avenues than football, basketball, or track. It really did.
Now, the most recent U.S. lacrosse annual survey indicated that nearly 500,000 youths are engaged in lacrosse, in organized lacrosse. Now, the sport remains the fastest growing team sport in secondary and intercollegiately as well. You founded RDC Lax Prep, mm-hmm. And you also serve as the program coordinator for Winners Lacrosse here in Washington, D.C. Talk about the importance of your efforts with those organizations.
Well, it's all about growing the game, Pat. You know, we have to make sure that the opportunities that Rodger Colbert were provided with is provided for others to scale, right? We need to make sure that these communities in Washington, D.C. have sticks in their hands, these communities, Newark, New Jersey, they have sticks in their hands so that kids can have options. That's what it's about. It's all about options and exposure. And so at Winners, we are literally every afternoon, we're somewhere inner city or we're somewhere in D.C. promoting lacrosse. We're at Friendship Tech in Southeast, we're at Chavez in Northwest, we're at Achievement Prep in Southeast, Congress Heights as well. And so the program is just to expose and put a stick in someone's hand and use me as a lever to do it. You know, I'll be a face for Winners because I am RCDC, right? So however it is, whomever it is I need to partner up with, that's what the Winners came out of,
right.
I will, because to me, it's my life mission to make sure that these young people are exposed and have the opportunity, that they know. There's scholarships at UDC. Right. Yeah, it's D2 school, but you can pay for your education. It's nothing better than to have paid for your own, to pay your own way, to pull up your own bootstraps and then give back. And
I
so
agree.
That's always been me.
I agree with you. Let's dispel a few myths. And you mentioned
Please.
Earlier Jim Brown, who was an All-American midfielder at Syracuse. We know that in the early 70s, Morgan State actually developed a program on the NCAA level. And
sure.
In 1975, upset Washington and Lee. It was a
yes,
huge collegiate upset. And obviously, with your own successes, we started our program back in 2013. Was the, I guess, the first HBCU
yes,
to
ma'am.
Develop, redevelop intercollegiate men's lacrosse. And now Hampton has followed as well. Can you discuss the contributions of black men in the sport? And so I believe it's you, Lloyd Carter at Hampton, mm-hmm. Rick Sowell at Navy.
Yeah. There are a couple others, you know, that are assistants. I think that's the new biggest push, right? In order for us to really grow the game the way that we need to grow the game, I think the people of color in our population are starting to realize that we need to have coaches in the seats in order to really push it forward.
That's right.
And so there's been a focus, a new focus on making sure that we're seen as coaches. And just to teeter off a bit, the coaches that are in place are having issues similar to the young men that are playing have in place, i.e. people still identify my assistant coach as the head coach, right? And you know, I can internalize that by myself, or I can galvanize with a group of men that are like visuals, like minds, and start to form something so that we can address these issues out loud and with one another without seeming as if we're complaining about what's not there. We know it's there because we see it and feel it every day. But our focus, probably more so than ever, is to ensure to develop young people to be coaches so that they understand that we have to develop it to grow the game, coaching side and the player side, Pat. So that's the newest focus. And my phone has been ringing the past couple of weeks, literally. Yesterday, I just received a call that
excellent
that states just this. Like, it's a problem that we've got to figure out how to address.
Excellent. Stay with us. Firebird Sports Magazine will return after this break.
Label me.
You know you want to.
Don't be shy.
You do it behind my back.
So say it to my face.
Hey, you don't know me. You know what I am?
I'm a pitcher.
I'm a striker.
I'm a point guard.
I'm a linebacker.
I'm a setter.
Shortstop.
High jumper.
Wrestler.
Defender.
Goalie.
Student.
Student athletes.
That's who we are.
I'm from Louisville, Kentucky. I'm a psychology major, and I'm graduating this May.
I think the most significant experience I've had at UDC was when I was accepted to receive a full scholarship to take a tour of the history of psychology in Europe. And I was able to go to London and Paris. I had never left the country before, and I learned a lot.
Lacrosse has been called the fastest game on 2 feet. The men's game combines elements of basketball, ice hockey, and football. A physical sport, stick to body and stick to stick contact is allowed. Consequently, in the men's game, players wear helmets with face masks, meeting specific performance specifications, and mouth guards. In addition, players wear shoulder and arm pads and gloves. The goalkeeper must wear a throat and chest protector. The NCAA Men's Rules Lacrosse Committee formulates the rules. Each team includes 10 players, including goalkeeper, defense, midfield, and attack. As a member of the East Coast Conference, the University of the District of Columbia men's lacrosse team competes in a perennially strong league. I talked to Coach Colbert about the growth of the men's lacrosse program at UDC. What does the University of the District of Columbia offer student athletes in terms of lacrosse?
I think we offer them a new home in Washington, D.C. And what do I mean by that? You have a Georgetown, you have a couple other schools, but lacrosse is not prominent on the D2 level anywhere close enough so that we can own this particular region, right? So if you look at it from a cost standpoint, in addition to the two coaches that you have on the men's lacrossing staff and you merge the two, I think those are our biggest assets, right? We have location costs and great coaching for any student athlete that comes on board. And so right now we're recruiting heavily in the local areas, whether it be Montgomery County, Prince George's County, the metro areas, and we're trying to supplement those kids with anyone that's interested in diversifying the game and playing the game at a very high level. I will say that, you know, there's stories that we offer everyone, or we're just specifically for historically black students. Yes, we would love for historically black students to play lacrosse at UDC, but what we found is diversifying the game has become easier at UDC because we have Canadians, we have students of color, we have Spanish students. If you're going to grow the game, you have to include all. And I think we do a great job at UDC of just that, having all. The commonality amongst all the young people are the heart and the pursuit, right? So they're going after the lacrosse ball on the lacrosse field, or academically they have to be pursuing. They have to be strong pursuers of education. And that's really that's not a culture shift, because I think we always promote healthy academics, but I think our boys are starting to understand that if you don't perform in a classroom, Coach Colbert will not extend your scholarship. And that has been a rude awakening for our boys as of late.
Perfect. I mean, and clearly you come from a very, very strong academic background. And your wife, Suika, is an associate professor at Georgetown.
Full professor now.
Full professor. Oh, my goodness. That's wonderful.
Yes.
Congratulations.
No worries. Just recently happened.
That is fabulous. I'm not surprised. Yeah. She's brilliant.
Thank you.
I have sifted through some of her work, actually. She co-edited a book on slavery and the continued impacts that slavery has even today. This is fascinating reading for me. It took me some time to really get through it. But talk about the University of the District of Columbia and academics, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. what it offers young men.
Well, I think it offers an opportunity. So our demographic hasn't been the 4.0 student, but we've had a bunch of 3.7s. Right, and they're diverse 3.7s. It's the Washington D.C. 3.7s, which you can find in the Jelani guys, or you can find a Canadian 3.7, which you can find in Tyler Mace.
Yeah.
Right, so those two examples of kids with high GPAs coming from very different backgrounds, but then you have the kid that has historically come to us with, you know, anywhere from a 2.0 to a 3.0, and I think UDC provides a place for all three of those students. The Canadian 3.7, the Washington 3.7, and let's just say the Woodbridge, Virginia 2.2, right? We want to move towards a 3.0, 3.1 team, which we have been doing for the last year, and away from the lower standard of grades, but we recognize that in growing the game, you have to provide opportunities of education, and UDC makes that easy.
Absolutely.
That's the part that makes it easy, right?
Absolutely.
We have students that haven't been as strong academically that can come in here, focus, and do well. And then those that do well maintain, so to speak. So it really touches all different types of students, different type of learners. That's a better way to put it, different type of learners. And we have those throughout our team, different type of learners. So
no question. Perfect.
I'm sorry, but I would like to move, because of my background and whatever you just said, I would like to move towards that 3.1 and 3.0.
Yes, yes.
Just makes life easier.
Sure.
You know, so. But UDC has been great in terms of helping us decipher which kids work for UDC and which ones don't.
Uh-huh.
And it's been pretty obvious with between Joe Lang and the admissions people.
Yeah, yeah. Knock on the helmet. your program has achieved some significant milestones this season in particular. What are your long-term goals for the program?
Well, I think we have to grow it, right? I think the biggest issue with us will always be competing with teams that have 40, 60, or 70 players. We're never gonna have more than 25, 30 players. And so recruiting to 25 to 30 means that you have to have a more condensed type roster. You have to have athletes. You can't just have supplemental players. You have to have athletes that play more than one role.
Mm-hmm.
And so our recruitment process is about recruiting those athletes with more than one role, figuring out, you know, who wants to accept UDC, who do we want, balancing the two. But ultimately, we want to be perennial postseason contenders. We want to be that.
Yes.
In order to be that, we literally need to grow a little bit. We do. We need to grow about 25. We have about 18 players on our roster. We should have had about 23, 24. I think if we get about 25 to 30, we can compete. It just has to be the right 25 to 30, Pat.
I hear you. Well, you're getting that done.
Yeah, but the goal is postseason and stay there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we want to be spoken about for years to come. So.
And what is it like competing in the ECC?
I mean, it's great. It's great in terms of the quality of competition. You know, it's mostly a New York-based conference with the Long Island teams. There's three or four Long Island teams.
Certainly.
Upstate New York is Robert Wesleyan. And so we're the southernmost team. I think it's great for our kids to get to travel to those particular schools. And to compete and actually having to have lost to these schools for 3 or 4 years and actually turn the dial. We've got our first victory against Malloy ever this season. And the change in the boys' post game has been exceptional. So I think it's great to work in the ECC.
What type of student-athlete are you recruiting?
We call them dogs, Pat. Sorry for lack of a better word. But kids that are going to run through the walls for their coaches.
Yeah.
And that can self-contain themselves in the classroom.
Yeah,
you have to be able to be self-motivated in a classroom. Coach Murphy and I cannot walk you to class. We will not walk you to class. And so the dogs are people that go after it. They go to get the bone. And wherever that bone is, it's a bone in the classroom today? If it is, let's go get it. Is it on the field today? Let's go get it there. So I'd say those type of kids are the ones that we want. And kids that espouse our personal values, you know, rigor, discipline, courage, and commitment. Those are the things that our core values. Do they espouse those values?
And what can a young man expect from you and Coach Murphy?
Woo! We're very direct. I tell young people, I will never lie to you. I might lie to your parent, but I will never lie to you. I'm very direct. There's no way around it. I'm not passive aggressive, I'm aggressive aggressive.
Yes, you are.
You know, you will always be loved. If you're mine, you're always going to be mine, good or bad.
Where are you and Kevin Murphy recruiting? What's your base?
Well, we go up to BC, British Columbia. We try to get, you know, one or two kids every 2 years from up north in Canada.
Okay.
We put it in a rotation like that. locally, the metro areas, Montgomery County, Prince George County. You know, I'm a New Jersey boy, New Jersey all the time. Atlanta, Houston, those are the new hotbeds. And we're going to branch out to California because that's Kevin's hometown as well.
Yes.
But those are the particular areas. And those are some of the areas in which, you know, the growth of lacrosse has taken place as well.
Right.
So we want to sort of piggyback on the efforts of the grassroots organizations and bring some young people into UDC.
Okay, and here in Washington, D.C., and among the public schools without mm-hmm. walls, and Wilson
JFK,
offers...
JFK, Wilson. Okay. We are in a process of planning a prospect camp. Hopefully, you'll get your approval so that we can have those kids, those schools come visit and actually play all at once, and so we can actually recruit from them, and they can be seen by us
That's
and other
great
college
idea.
Coaches. So we have spoke to JFK already in a school without walls. So it's sort of happening organically, and a lot of people are coming to us now, which is a difference. And they want to be a part of what it is we have bubbling and growing.
That's exciting. That
it's
is
really exciting.
Really exciting. Yeah. So how can a prospective student athlete contact you?
The coaches, the email, roger.colbert@udc.edu, kevin.murphy@udc.edu, and then the website has my phone number. I won't blast it here, but you guys can go get it. And Kevin Murphy is excellent about returning emails. I won't say I am because that's not true. But if you call me, I'll pick up the phone.
Rodger Colbert was instrumental in laying the foundation for the men's lacrosse program at the University of the District of Columbia. The sport has been an integral part of Coach Colbert's life, and he is eager to help young men achieve the same successes he has experienced on and off the playing field. I'm Patricia Thomas. Thanks for watching.